So these neural networks are able to make predictions on unseen data sets. And what we can see here is a comparison of some experimental measurements along with the predictions from the machine learning or from these neural networks. And we can see that these are doing quite well at recapitulating the experimental data. And there's sort of this expectation for how neural networks are working. We're expecting them to learn biological meaningful features in these neural networks or in this data sets. But is this true? Are these actually learning biological features such as motifs and higher order rules? So there's this sort of push recently towards interpretability of neural networks in genomics. So trying to understand what specific features are being used by these neural networks in order to make their predictions. So one such example is this global importance analysis from Peter Koo's lab. And the general idea is it's this framework that we can use for determining the effect of these putative features on neural network predictions. And this works when you have these neural networks that are modeling sequence to function relationships, such as these typical functional assays like gene expression. And we can use sort of this general approach to investigate simpler features such as motifs, but also you can look into more complex features, so how these motifs are interacting with your cooperativity and things like that. So we wanted to see if we could use, we wanted to see whether or not these neural networks were learning true biology in enhancers. So in our lab, we study enhancers. And for those who don't know, these are these DNA regulatory sequences that are able to drive cell type specific gene expression. They're mediated through the binding of different transcription factors, which recognize specific patterns of motifs or patterns of sequences known as motifs. And a specific instance of a motif I'm just referring to as a transcription factor binding site. And we actually have these relatively recently, we have access to these genome-wide functional assays that can look for and sequences that can drive transcription genome-wide. For example, there's the STARseq assay, which is quite popular. And this is just an example from a recent Nature paper, pretty much just showing for a given sequence, for a given region of the genome, they're showing the experimental measurements for STARseq. And they're also comparing it to their predictions from a neural network. And we can see it's quite well. There is a little bit of noise there, but it's doing quite well. So we were interested to see, so in our lab, we study mesenteric stem cells, which we know quite well. So we want to see whether or not neural networks trained on these embryonic stem cell enhancers are learning sort of the biology that we're expecting them to, and not just sort of random things that are not interpretable. So today I'm gonna be focusing on motifs. So motifs or transcription factor binding sites, these really serve as the building blocks for enhancers. And through which these the interaction with these develop important. But today, just for the sake of time, I'm going to focus on these motifs. So we know quite well which specific motifs are known to be important in those embryonic stem cell enhancers. So we wanted to see whether or not the neural network was picking up these motifs. So we took this deep star neural network, and you can see the architecture here, and it's quite standard. And we trained it on mesembryonic stem cell enhancer activity from STARseq. And these two ILNS cells just represent two different media conditions, but they're both naive embryonic stem cells. And this is just showing on a held up test chromosome. We're looking at the correlation between the measured activity from the STARseq assay along with the neural network predicted activity. And we can see the correlations around 0.61, 0.62 for each task. It's performing okay. It's sort of similar to what was seen in the deep star paper for the neural network architecture that we're using. But again, the question that we have is it actually learning about known transcription factor motifs? And for the rest of the talk, I'm really gonna focus on this 2IL media type or this for these 2IL mesenteric stem cell enhancers. Again, 2IL is just the media conditions that are used. And this just represents more homogeneous cell type. So to determine what the important motifs are, this is sort of the general experiment that we have. So we take a bunch of randomly generated sequences, which we call this no motif set. And then we have some motif A that we're interested in. We can insert that motif into random positions of each of those sequences. And then also as a control, we take a scrambled version of that motif and insert it into another similar set of those sequences. We can then feed these to the neural network and ask it to make the predictions. And then we can compare these sets to see if the neural network is putting importance on this given motif versus the scrambled motif, which is serving as a control. And as you can see on the right-hand side, It seems like the set of sequences with a real motif inserted, the predicted activity on average is a lot higher than the scrambled control and also just the no motif backbone sequence. And sort of to quantify this in a single number, we're using effect size. So for example, in this case, the effect size is comparing the real motif set with the no motif set. That's what the motif 2.38 represents, and the scrambled is comparing the scrambled with the no motif. So we did this using a large set of motifs from the Jasper database, and this is sort of different from the standard approach where we try and learn these position weight matrix motifs directly. So in this case, we take known motifs from the database, and we want to see which of these the neural network is placing importance on. So there's 841 of these motifs that we ended up using, and we narrow this down to about 165. Here, what you're seeing here is just for each of these 841 motifs, we calculated the effect size for the real motifs against this backbone set and the scrambled motifs against the backbone set. The scrambled motif kind of serves as our null expectation. And then we use the cutoff of the max effect size from the scrambled motif set to sort of find what the important motifs are. So we found about 165 important motifs here. Now, is this what we expected? So it includes a lot of these sort of master regulators, mouse hemorrhage stem cells, which is what we were expecting. So OCT4, SOX2, ESRRB, KLF4, though we can kind of see that specific motifs have a lot stronger effects than other motifs. Additionally, though, there's 161 other motifs that were found. What are these and sort of are they what we expect? So I just cherry picked a few of these that we can see. So ELF1, USF2, NFE2L2. So typically when we're studying mouse embryonic stem cell enhancers, we really focus on these regulators, at least that's what's in the current literature. These different transcription factor motifs, they're known to be important in human embryonic stem cells, but they're not typically considered in mouse embryonic stem cells. So again, is this sort of what we were expecting to see for what motifs were important? And again, the current understanding in the literature is that these master regulators are really important for making predictions, and we do see that their importance with varying effect size. However, the neural network is clearly putting importance on a large repertoire of motifs that are not typically associated with when considering mouse embryonic stem cell enhancers. And this is actually consistent with previous results that we published last year in genome research. And this was on, instead of looking at SARS-seq data, we were looking at conservation of sort of proxies of enhancer activity between mouse and human. So conservation of ATAC-seq, H3K27 acetylation, so these signatures of active enhancers. And similarly, we found that a lot more motifs than these master regulators are important for making these, or in embryonic stem cell enhancers. So this is sort of consistent with that. Now, sort of the next steps that I want to do is I want to validate in the wet lab that these specific motifs are actually important. So the ones that are being identified by the neural network, besides sort of these well-known ones, are the other ones actually important? So we can sort of design these synthetic sequences and validate them using these in vitro reporter assays to sort of see whether or not this is true and this is actually real biology. And unfortunately, I don't have time to talk about this today, but sort of one of the cool things about neural networks is their ability to model sort of this non-linearity in the data, which we're expecting to see looking at these higher order rules, such as like the number of different binding sites, the copy number of binding sites, or sort of the cooperativity between different binding sites or motifs. So that's sort of what I'm sort of looking to work on next. And I do have some initial results if people want to sort of talk to me after during the pizza session, because that's sort of where the really interesting stuff comes. Thank you everyone for listening.